All right, thanks. Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Jeff Ryan, K0RM, president of Rocky Mountain Ham Radio. And thank you all for participating in this, the 2020-2021, did I just say that? Version of Rocky Mountain Ham University. Really appreciate everybody's participation, especially appreciate the presenters, the folks that put the information together. I don't know if Mike is updated. I would expect his presentation. I've seen it several times and always enjoy it. So I keep coming back for more. So thanks, Mike. Really appreciate the efforts that you put into this. I've actually seen this done outside of Colorado by Mike as well. He takes this show on the road. It's always very popular and well attended. As you are no doubt aware, Rocky Mountain Ham Radio is a completely donor-supported organization. We do not have dues from our members. Our members participate by doing things and showing up at events and helping us get our work done, and we feel that that's enough. So the way we collect money is by having people donate, and there's any number of ways that you can do that. If you go to the website, rmham.org, on the right-hand side of the top menu, you'll see why donate. If you click on that, there's any number of methods that you can participate in helping us financially. So without any further ado, thanks everybody for being here. Welcome to Rocky Mountain Ham University, and I'll turn it over to Mike. Take it away, please.
Am I coming out? There I go. Excellent. All right, for you folks at home, you guys actually have a better seat at the moment, because inside the room here, we have some folks that are participating and sitting in live. However, we don't have the slide deck up on the wall yet for people to see. It's coming very quickly, but it's currently not there. So right now we're doing a little tap dance while this happens, because not only can the people inside not see, I can't see what slide I'm presenting. So it puts a dent in the whole experience. So to start out, my name is Mike Lozano. I am K0NGA. You might know me from places such as this presentation every year at RMHAM. I seem to be the guinea pig every year starting off the thing, and I'm perfectly okay with that. I also have some videos up on a YouTube channel about doing DMR programming and those kind of things, hotspots. But the DMR is what got me really, really deep into amateur radio. I was kind of interested, got my license, didn't do much to it. But then when DMR started getting popular, that's how I got hooked in. So it's really nice for me to be able to come anytime I can to present to folks that may be new to using DMR in amateur radio, which is, I can tell you, from my first experience, it's not always easy to get started. And there's reasons for that. And I'd like to put those reasons up on the screen as soon as possible. We'll get there. I don't want to get too ahead of myself. And neither can these folks. I see it. So I can see it up on, we have a live feed of all the video up on one screen. So we can see like a very, very tiny version of the slide, which is hilarious. So DMR best practices, we're going to go and get started with the early stuff, and we'll need to get the big slides up for the folks in the room when we get into deep into the topic. So let me see if I can get this work. There we go. All right. So I start out every presentation about DMR with this particular slide. This slide has evolved over the years because I keep having to repeat myself on this a lot, and I get a little frustrated. So we'll talk about DMR. First thing to understand is that DMR was created for commercial use. This is the first thing, especially for experienced hams who have been in amateur radio for a while. This is the first thing you really need to get your head around, is that DMR is not a ham radio protocol. It's created for commercial use. Now, if you're a commercial radio user, it makes a lot more sense. But if you're in amateur, just all your radio experience like me has all been in amateur radio, this is gonna be fun, all right? Now, along with that, come on, there we go. It was never designed or intended for amateur radio use, okay? Some things about DMR aren't gonna make sense, okay? Accept this, it will make your life easier, okay? Don't fight it, don't argue about it, because you can argue about it all you want, but it's not gonna change, So it's going to be a lot easier for you to learn this and understand it if you just accept the fact that it's different and put all your energy into learning how to use it and how to program it and that kind of a thing. I put this up every time as my first slide because this really is important to get your mindset in the right place going forward. All right, so what is DMR? Now, you've also heard the term turbo, probably if you've been in this arena for a while. DMR is an abbreviation for digital mobile radio. It's very esoteric, right? Very hard to remember, DMR, digital mobile radio. It is an international commercial digital radio standard that came out of Europe, right? And because it's an international standard, it's really, really easy to be able to build a radio around it. So if you are a hardware provider or a radio provider and you want to be able to do a DMR radio, it's an international standard, right? So you can, everybody and their dog can make a radio. And as, if you've been in this for any length of time, you know that everybody and their dog does make a radio. More on that later. Now, Turbo, T-R-B-O, is short for Moto Turbo. And Moto Turbo deals with Motorola's implementation of the DMR standard. So they'll take their radio equipment with that is DMR compatible and they'll put things around it. The most significant for us is IP Site Connect, which allows you to connect repeaters together without having to use, you know, at a base level without you have to using intermediate hardware. More on that later. But it's still a DMR repeater, okay? So many amateur radios use this Moto Turbo equipment because there's a lot of used equipment you can get on eBay for cheap, or it used to be that way. I'm pretty sure it's probably still that way. And so they'll call their networks turbo networks because it uses Moto Turbo equipment. We certainly did that when we first got started. But you do not have to have a Motorola radio to be able to transmit and receive on these repeaters and on these networks. That's an important thing to understand. You don't have to have a Motorola radio. Okay. Now, for you folks that are out in the stream, if you have questions, please put the questions in the chat. And we'll either have our guys working in the back end here get those questions out to me or whatnot. But if you do have a question, please feel free. Inside here, raise your hands on the stream, put it in the chat, and we'll get to it as we go along. Okay. So that's really just kind of the basic of the background of this. All right, let's get into this. Now, why do we care about DMR? Why is this important to us? Why do we like it? And why in the world has it exploded in the amateur radio world? I mean, DMR has not been around terribly long, 5-10 years, but it's exploded. And there's really, really good reasons why, okay? The first reason is that it's digital, okay? It's a digital technology. So instead of sending modulated analog signals, we're sending ones and zeros essentially over the air, okay? And what that means is that the signal stays clearer longer. So for an analog signal, as you get it further away and the power starts to drop out, your clarity and readability kind of drops on a line, right? Digital doesn't work that way. As long as the repeater and the radio can discern a one from a zero, the clarity and readability stays the same, generally. And it is until you get right to the edge of that signal, being able to determine between a one and a zero, that the readability just drops off a ledge, okay? So it stays clearer longer, given the same power, right? That's a very, very important thing. Now, the other thing, now that I have my slide up here, fantastic. The other thing about, there's several things. That's the first thing, it's digital. The second thing is that it's narrow band. It's a commercial technology. Remember that, right? It's commercial technology. And in the United States by law, going forward, all commercial repeaters have to be narrow band, right? Now that's a good thing because it allows it to put more repeater in the same bandwidth. Okay, so we'll come back to that in just a second. The last thing is that in the versions of the DMR repeaters that we use, there are two time slots, which are also called repeater slots. More often time, I believe it's called a repeater slot. You'll hear the terms repeater slot and time slot, throw them back and forth. They're the same thing. Don't get tripped up on that. But what that means is that you can have one repeater with one frequency pair and have two simultaneous conversations going on that don't bump into each other. Simultaneous independent conversations using the same repeater, using the same input and output frequencies. So that one repeater acts kind of like two independent repeaters, if you think about it that way. So now we've got two virtual repeaters in a narrowband space. So if you think about it, within the wideband space that we use in amateur radio, we can now fit two repeaters because it's narrowband, and we have two virtual repeaters per repeater. So we've got four conversations going on, potentially, in that bandwidth where before we could only have one. And that is fantastic because we don't have to go and allocate additional bandwidth to get additional repeaters for additional conversation streams. If you think about it that way, we can just put those two repeaters in that space and have four conversations going on at the same time. These three factors put together is really, I believe, why DMR has exploded.
Looks like we lost Firestone for a second.
We got a little lag going on here. All right, so the frequency pair isn't a new concept for repeaters. Everybody knows it should know an input and output frequency, right? So that's the same. It's a repeater, okay? But that's really where the similarities between DMR and analog amateur radio kind of end. There are some kind of conceptual overlap, but the terminology here starts to change, okay? Instead of a CTCSS or DCS tone, we have something called a color code. Now, the color code's a fun thing because the color code isn't a color. It's a number. Because obviously, right? It's a number. Now, this it serves the same function. So if you're in an area of very, very dense repeater deployments and you're running low on frequencies, you can have repeaters sharing a repeater pair, but you can use a different color code in each repeater to keep them from interfering with each other. Serves the same function. So we get a repeater pair, we got a color code. It's the first thing, first two things going in. Now, the next things you're gonna run into is the repeater slot, which I mentioned before, okay? So when you're talking on a repeater, you have to know which repeater slot you're on. Because if you're talking on one repeater slot and somebody else is talking on a different repeater slot, they're independent and you're not gonna be talking to each other. Conceptually, you have to be talking on the same repeater slot in order to be able to communicate with each other. That's important. So you have to know frequency pair, color code, repeater slot. And finally, we start talking about things called talk groups. Now, if you've been on any Brandmeister website or any independent DMR repeater website with an active community, you've probably heard this term swapped around. Everybody talks about talk groups, talk groups, talk groups, talk groups, right? So talk groups are a further split within a repeater slot. Now, you can still only have one conversation going on at a time. So if you have multiple talk groups on a repeater slot, only one of those talk groups can be active and transmitting at any point in time, right? You can have more than one active, but only one can actually be transmitting at any point in time. So if I'm transmitting on a talk group on a repeater slot, and someone comes in another talk group on that same repeater slot and tries to transmit, they're gonna get a busy signal, the reality of the way that it works. Now, when we're talking programming, you'll also have a receive group, which you'll program into the channel. This receive group can hold more than one talk group. Now they did that because you can have more than one talk group on a channel. And if another talk group is transmitting, you want to be able to listen to it on your radio so you can know when the conversation's over and when you can start transmitting and talking in a different talk group to another person, right? Again, it's commercial technology. This design and usability, this interface and the way that this works was designed for commercial users. It was not designed for amateur radio use. But as amateur radio enthusiasts, we all love taking things and shoehorning and making it do things it wasn't supposed to do because that's kind of what we do. Any questions in the chat? Not so far. Excellent. Okay. Now, how do we get started? What do I do? All right. First thing you need to do is get a radio. First of all, it has to be a DMR compatible radio. You can't use an analog amateur radio on a DMR repeater and talk DMR. The radio has to support the DMR protocol, okay? Now, you'll see these things running about tiers, tier one, tier two, whatever. You want a tier two radio. A tier two radio basically means two audio channels instead of an audio channel and a data channel, basically. But anything you see out in the marketplace that is geared towards amateur radio use, it's gonna be a tier two radio with some notable exceptions which try to cheat, and those radios we don't like to talk about, we put them on the naughty list and we ask you not to use them on our repeaters because they don't follow the protocols and the DMR tier two spec, and they cause problems. Okay. But nowadays, most of the radios that are coming out are good. They've learned that lesson and are good to go. Now, generally speaking, you get what you pay for. All right. This, we start talking about technology religion, radio religion here. Okay. You've got your Chinese radio adherence and you've got your Motorola adherence. That's really not the important thing here. The important thing is that what can you afford and what do you need? Okay. If you need a radio that needs to be able to survive, if you're on a tower and you drop it to the ground 30 feet, you're going to have to pay money for a radio like that. It's just the way it is. If you're mostly in your house and you just need a radio to get started, buying an appropriate Chinese radio for like $100 is a great way to get online. There's nothing wrong with that, right? I'm not about radio shaming and kink shaming and that kind of thing when it comes to technology like this. But pay, you know, you get what you pay for, and you can't expect a $100 Chinese radio to survive when it gets run over by a snowmobile. It just isn't going to happen. But it depends on what you need, right? There are some other capabilities, which we'll go into later, which may steer you towards one direction or another. But we'll talk about that. Ask around and get user's experience. I'm happy to give you my experience offline, because these videos tend to go up on YouTube, and I don't feel comfortable giving out recommendations on like that publicly. I'll do that in private. Check the radio list at RMHAM.org. If your club, and our club does it, have sample co-plugs, check those co-plugs and see what's available. Okay. The feature sets along these radios can vary widely. The choice of radios mainly is what's important to you. I'm a contactless junkie. There are certain radios that don't support a whole lot of contactless entries. Again, we'll go into this a little bit later. And there are some that have a lot. I tend to be a junkie. I like tend to towards the radios that have a larger number of contactless entries that are supported in the radio, but that's just me. Okay. User, get a radio that has a sample co plug available or is supported by the N0 GSG utility. Let me tell you about this utility. It's called the contactless manager, but nowadays it does a whole lot more than just contactless management. If you go to your favorite search engine, Google, and go in and put in N0 GSG contactless utility, it'll take you there. It allows you to translate between code plugs for the radios that it supports. So you open a code plug, a blank code plug or whatever for the radio that you have, and you can import a code plug from another radio that it supports, and it'll suck in all the channels, the zones, the contact list and everything in, and allow you to translate and get a code plug that you can use. It's fantastic. Also, I strongly recommend that if you use it, it's donationware. Throw money at this guy, because this utility has saved me so much time, right? And it'll save you a ton of time too. I highly recommend it. And no, I'm not associated with him. I don't get any money for saying that. It's just a great, great tool. Any questions in the chat? Okay, excellent. So the first thing you need to do is get a radio, because DMR radio is required to do this. All right. It's not. Beep. There it goes. The next thing, another thing that is unique to DMR based versus amateur radio, is this concept of a radio ID. Now, every radio on any given network, whether it be the RMHAM network, the Brandmeister network, the DMR Mark radio, for best operability should have their own unique radio ID. Now that's fine and dandy when you've got control of your own network, your commercial entity, and you only have, you know, 100,000 users, and you can put out radio these yourself. But this is an entire amateur radio community talking on a worldwide connected repeater network. How in the world do we make sure that our radio ID is unique? And the answer to that is there's an organization called radioid.net. Used to be the part of DMR Mark, but they split it off to their own separate entity. It's nonprofit. You go to the site, you give them your information, including your call sign, and they assign you an ID. And that way you can make sure that the ID that you're using is going to be unique no matter where you use it in the amateur radio community. Okay? You must have one of these. Please go get one of these. And you don't have to have your radio yet in order to get the ID. You can, if you've ordered a radio, you can get your ID while you wait for your radio to arrive. But go ahead and do that as soon as possible, because that'll get you started quickly. All right. John says that that's a German group. It's European, but it is still a nonprofit, and they're the ones that have done this for the community. They don't charge for it, which is fantastic, but it's one of these things that is so important to make sure that operability is clean in these very, very large networks like Brandmeister. Now, this comes up a lot, and so it's one of the things that I like to make sure I address early. There are some people in the community who believe that because you have this unique radio ID, that this counts as IDing your call sign when you transmit. And we have got this confirmed. It is not a replacement. So that means even though you have a unique radio ID, when you're transmitting, the FCC rules say that you have to be able to transmit audibly. Right? You still have to do that. Right? You have to transmit your call sign. And that is the key little thing in this. You have to transmit your call sign. And even though your radio ID is tied to a call sign in the database somewhere, you are not technically transmitting your call sign. Right, it's not an FCC database. So you still have to ID audibly. Now this gets fun when we start talking about things about text messaging and all this kind of stuff. But for today, it is very, very important that every 10 minutes, even when I do the net, I do this every 10 minutes when I'm on net, you ID your call sign because it's still a requirement. Your radio ID is not a replacement for a call sign. It's important to know. All right. Yes. Okay. Okay. So the question that came up is, can you use multiple IDs? The answer is yes, but in my mind, it should be discouraged simply because you only need the one. Now, if you have multiple radios, and I have multiple radios because I do code plugs, long story, you can put the same ID in multiple radios, okay? Now, the key there is that, again, for operability, you only should have one radio running and transmitting on one network at a time. You don't want two radios on the same network transmitting and receiving. Things can get kind of weird when that happens. So it's best to limit it to one radio at a time. For me, I only have one radio on at a time. It's either my handheld or it's the radio in my car. So I turn off the radio in my car, turn the radio on, that I have in my handheld, use the same radio ID. That's fine because there's only one radio active with that ID at any point in time. So you do not need a separate ID for every physical radio. And in fact, because there is a finite number of IDs that can put out, it's usually best to use as few radio IDs as you can get away with. Start with one and only go to two and or three if you absolutely have a very, very strong need and use case for it. That is my recommendation. Right. So what Doug is saying is that two radios with the same ID have trouble communicating with each other as well, right? It gets very, very weird. Just the best thing to keep in mind is just avoid having two radios with the same ID on at the same time. Question in the room. All right, so the question here has to do with radio IDs when it comes to things like repeaters and hotspots, right? Every unit, either a repeater or radio on the network has to have their own ID. So you'll have actually a repeater ID as well. When you start talking about hotspots are like miniature, very, very low power, limited kind of repeaters. That's really what they are, but they have to have an ID. But the cool thing about those is that you can use your radio ID and then append a one or two number to the end of it. So like my number would be, 355, whatever. So you just add a 01 or a 1 to the end of it and put that into your hotspot, and then that works. So not only does that get it. Now in the software, this is Connect System software. I'll show you a different screenshot of the different software in a little bit. But in the software, there'll be a place to put your radio ID. Anytone, which is the other software they use, does some weird things, go figure, in their code plug software. But you do have to put your radio ID in the software, and then like everything else, you put it in there, save it, and then you upload it to your radio. So make sure that you do that when you get your radios. You have to use the software to get it up in there. unless it's a little bit, leverage the sample code plugs. Sample code plugs are just that, they're samples, right? But the cool thing is that people like me and other folks that maintain them at RMHAM and other clubs have done all the hard work for you. You can get this code plug software. You don't even have to load it into your radio, just load it into your code plug software and look at it to get an idea of where things are and how things are supposed to work, what a channel is supposed to look like, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? So our code plugs have all the RMHAM repeaters automatically programmed in, right? We're not gonna put in every repeater in existence. Who has that kind of time? Not me. Who has that kind of patience? Definitely not me, right? But it is absolutely the quickest way to get on the air. So you'll have, you pull it in, you have your repeaters already programmed in, you choose a zone that has the repeaters near you, tune it, transmit, and you can get on the air. It's the quickest way to get going, right? Now, what we encourage you to do is use these as a foundation for creating your own code plugs. You wanna put your own repeaters in there? You wanna put another club's repeaters in there? Fantastic, just add them in. There's nothing wrong with that, right? We encourage that. Again, the other thing is that, again, I mentioned this utility, use it as a starting point for managing your code plug using the N0GSG utility. Because once you get that code plug open in N0GSG, you can export it out as a spreadsheet, you can manipulate it within the utility, delete zones, add channels, do whatever you want, right? That's what the sample code plugs are for, to get you started. Enjoy it, have at it, okay? But they're out there, not just from RMHAM, but from other clubs. Use them. They're open and free and freely offered. All right. So another quick conversation about this before we get into the programming session, which is really the meat of what I wanted to cover this morning. Again, talk groups and repeater slots. There is a lot of conversation about this, and this, you know, for people that talk on Brandmeister and things, when we start talking about the technical works and whatnot, this comes up a lot, so it's important to get this down, okay? Again, each repeater has two repeater slots, also called time slots, okay? Each slot can handle one conversation at a time, which means a repeater as a unit can handle two simultaneous conversations, one on repeater slot one, one on repeater slot two, okay? Now, in the early days, I don't remember this in the early days because I was looking at, okay, great, these are repeaters in my area. I need to travel. I'll go to the site and find other DMR repeaters in areas where I'm traveling. And you'll see a repeater, and it'll have 37 talk groups on a time slot. You think about that for a minute. It's like, if that's an active repeater, how in the world are 37 different individual groups that have their own time slot going to be able to effectively use the repeater if they're talking over each other, trying to? Right? It's a recipe for disaster, in my opinion, but it's still there as a feature because these radios were designed for commercial use. This feature was not put in there for amateur radio enthusiasts. It was not. And a lot of people kind of misunderstood that, I think, early on and got, you know, tripped over themselves because people were complaining, I can never transmit. It's like, do you have all the talk groups and receive groups? And no, I just want to transmit on this one. Why would I need to? Because somebody else is talking on the talk group, right? It doesn't just magically split itself out. One conversation per talk group. And you have to be aware of that, okay? So the thing here, the lesson here is that to monitor the other talk groups on the repeater slot so that you can tell if there's another conversation going on and if the time slot is free. There's two ways to do this. There's the proper way, quote, in air quotes, proper way, which is to put every talk group that is on that repeater in the receive group that you assign to that channel. So that any of those talk groups that are active, it'll activate your speaker and you'll be able to hear it. Then there's the cool lazy way, which is use something, a feature in your radio called digital monitor. Now this is sometimes called promiscuous mode, the very, very fancy term that has been put around in networking for the longest time that they decided to apply here for some reason. Won't go into the history of that because it's a little weird, but it's the digital monitor. What digital monitor essentially does is that any talk group that transmits on your channel that matches your frequency pair and your frequency pair, your color code, and your time slot, any talk group that transmits, your radio will open the speaker. Right. So basically, it's an all-encompassing kind of thing, which means that anything that transmits that matches, that's going to interfere with your ability to transmit, it'll open up and it'll let you to listen to. a digital monitor. So it's a channel monitor feature, right? And that's the one that I like, I recommend, because it's a lot less programming to make that happen. Question.
Hey, Mike, this is a question from the internet regarding a previous topic.
Okay.
Chris Keller, K0SWE, says, regarding DMR code plugs, is there a good way to combine code plugs? Does N0GSG do that? I have RMHAM, Aries channels, plus other miscellaneous stuff I want, and managing them by hand is a little painful.
The answer to that question is yes. Use the N0GSG utility. It absolutely does that. So if you have one code plug that you open, you can import another code plug, and it'll just add. And you add another, open another code plug, and it'll just add. So yes, use the N0GSG utility for that purpose. Absolutely. That's awesome. And that's why I point so many people to it, because it does so many things and solves so many problems, right? It'll be like, my thing is to go learn that utility and use it, and then come back to me for questions beyond that, because it solves so many problems and answers so many questions. Good question, thank you. All right, so digital monitor is your friend. Use it, learn it, be happy with it. We've actually used that to catch some other things just beyond people being too chatty on a talk group. But it's important to understand this talk group to repeater slot relationship. Now, the funny thing there is that technically, and somebody correct me if I'm wrong, you can have the same talk group on two repeater slots, but if you're on a different repeater slot from the one the other person's on, you're not going to hear each other because the conversation is tied to a repeater slot, right? Within a repeater. Once you start transmitting and throwing things back and forth between repeaters, that's a whole different conversation. All right. Here is another thing that's come up, and this came up pretty quickly. Now, at RMHAM, when the RMHAM network was first launched, and when I got into it, we had five main talk groups, right? And we have a one talk group per repeater slot policy, which means any repeater on in our network, especially this is still true in Colorado generally, is that repeater slot one will be the Rocky Mountain wide or Rocky Mountain talk group. And then the second repeater slot would be a talk group that is tied to a region, north, south, central, which used to be called Denver, now it's called central because it's spread far beyond Denver now. So you could tell when you were transmitting on that where it was going to be, but it'd be one talk group per repeater slot. Okay. Now that's all well and good if you only have your radio on and you only sit on that one talk group all day. I am not that kind of person, right? I will scan around all the talk groups to catch conversations that go on because where I lived at the time, I could get to at least one repeater that carried every talk group, right? So I could monitor all five talk groups very easily from where I was. So I'd scan around. Now, the problem with that is that you're sitting there at your desk or doing whatnot. Somebody transmits, right? Say it was Doug that transmitted. This is K2AD. And look over my radio, and the transmission has already stopped. What talk group did he transmit on? No idea, because he didn't announce his talk group. Now, if he says, comes back and he says, this is K2AD on Central, oh, yeah, I know, he was on the Central talk group. So I can go back to my radio, and any repeater that I can get to that has access to the Central talk group, I can respond on that channel, right? So the key here is that now that we're in this the whole DMR thing, where you respond to is not tied to the repeater that you're on.
Another question here from Dante K0FXS. FXF. Boy, that's a tough one.
Say that three times fast.
Are the RMHAM region-based repeaters/talk groups available via a hotspot?
The answer to that question is mostly. We our North, Central, and South talk groups are available via Brandmeister. There is a Brandmeister specific page on our website that lists the Brandmeister talk groups that map to our internal regional talk groups, North, Central, and South. What that means is that you can get to those by taking your hotspot, connecting them to Brandmeister, and then transmitting on those talk groups. So the answer to that question is yes, mostly.
And that is running at somebody's house. Your mileage may vary. Batteries are not included, so.
Void or prohibited, see store for details, do not pass go.
We are working to upgrade that so it's more stable and in a central location, but it is not yet.
I would say consider that feature an experimental feature at this time, not necessarily a production feature, but yes, you can do that.
We do need people to help us monitor and make sure that it's working properly. And if somebody wants to be a sysadmin for that, let us know.
All right, excellent. So identify your talk group. This is very, very important for anybody that does a lot of scanning. Also on Brandmeister, if you monitor Brandmeister repeaters or have a Brandmeister, have your hotspot set up for Brandmeister, if you're monitoring a whole bunch of talk groups, it's very, very handy to not have to go back into your hotspot. What was that transmission coming from? In order to be able to respond quickly. So again, new operating practices because of the way that DMR works, right? And when we announce our DMR net and talk group, so it's just your local repeater, just be on the Rocky Mountain talk group at 7 o'clock. Kind of new concepts. All right, so let's talk about actually getting this stuff into your radio, right? The concepts here apply to any DMR radio, whether it be Motorola or Chinese, which is the two general categories that we talk about nowadays. However, every single radio manufacturer tends to really like to make their own software. And sometimes these manufacturers try to get fancy and they'll change the terms of things around, which is extraordinarily annoying. So if you get a radio that hasn't been in the market for a while, you may have to dig in a little bit to figure out where things are, where things go, and what things are called. It's very, very discouraging. And when we talk to people about it, we're like, don't change the names. Just use the same names, darn it, please. All right. But it happens way too much. All right. Let's get into this. Basic programming concepts we've already covered. All right. So we're going to review. In order to be able to program a channel at a basic level, you need to know the repeater input and output frequencies, the frequency pair, obviously. We need to know the color code, which again is a number. For some weird reason, why didn't they call it a number code or an entry code or an access code? No, they had to call it a color code. I would like to see a chart somewhere with somebody put the color codes and they put the associated colors with it, which don't matter, right? Ugh. The desired talk group that you want to communicate on, right? And the repeater slot that talk group is on that repeater. Okay. This doesn't matter as much on Brandmeister for certain reasons, which we'll get into later, but the repeater slot still matters. So you need to know your repeater slot. Okay. Now, this is a screenshot from within the Anytone software. It is the channel screen. It's a little hard to see inside the room here, but let me see if we can go over some things. You've got the channel name at the top. You guys on the stream can't see this, but you can zoom in and it makes it easier than the people in the room. You've got your transmit and receive frequencies. Over here, you've got your contact. They call it a contact. A lot of software says they call it contact. This is your transmit talk group. They call it a contact. Ugh. Never mind the fact that unlike everything else in the software, which is a pull-down menu, In the Anytone software, it's a button. And when you press that button in the software, it brings up a grid with all of your talk groups in a grid. And then you double click on the talk group in order to choose the talk group that you want to put in there. Instead of a pull down menu, like the whole darn rest of the screen. Because Anytone just needs to be different. I don't know. I don't know why they did it. I want to select two. And then what do we got here? The receive group that you selected. And all these kind of things. Those are the basic things. Now, there's a lot of other stuff on this screen that you don't need to worry about. We can talk about, you know, real quick, the encryption bit, which you don't do in amateur radio, because in amateur radio, you're not allowed to code or encrypt transmissions. So you never turn encryption on ever, because it's illegal, right? Over here, channel type. Now, most DMR radios will support both digital and analog channels. So yes, you can use your DMR radio to talk to analog DMR, non-DMR amateur radio repeaters, which is fantastic. What do we got else in there? All these other things. The channel width is another important thing. If you're on digital, the channel width should, in most radios, default to 12.5. In this one, it doesn't. So if you're doing this in an Anytone radio, when you have digital, you need to make sure that your channel width is set to 12.5, which is narrowband, right? If you're doing an analog channel, 25K, right? Because it's a wideband. There are some narrowband analog amateur radio repeaters out there. just make sure that that matches. Okay. But for the most part, the different stuff is over here on this side for the Anytone radios. Analog radios also have all these wonderful DC, TCS, and DCS stuff at the bottom, as per normal. Again, most of the stuff you won't have to worry about, but it's there. But that's what a channel looks like. This is the blank default channel that you get when the radio is not programmed. This is how it comes up. So we need to program it. So let's get to it. We talked about the color code, right? Back one. Okay. Oh, it's going to make me rebuild it. Great. Okay. So the color code is the first access point past the repeater pair. It works like a CTS or DCS access tone and an analog repeater, only it applies to both send and receive at the same time, all the time. Okay. You must know your color code of the repeater in order to successfully use the repeater. This has kind of tripped us up every once in a while because we'll forget that, oh, we didn't set that repeater to 7, we set it to 6, or we set it to 8. We've sent out a sample code plug with the wrong color code and people wonder why that we can't transmit on it. It happens, we're human. But the color code has to be correct for the repeater. Now, a lot of people ask, where do we find out this information? And the short answer to that, and it's not really, it sounds snarky, but it's not, and that is from the repeater owner. It's like, well, we don't know the repeater owner. He doesn't have a website. How do we access the repeater? You don't. It's up to him to communicate the information to the people he wants on the repeater. If he doesn't have a website and doesn't put it out publicly, he doesn't want you on your repeater. That's the end of the story, right? We publish all of ours publicly. It's up on a website. It's all there, right? It can be a little overwhelming, which is why we have the sample. Did I mention the sample code plugs? I think I mentioned the sample code plugs, right? Yeah, that's a joke, isn't it? Yeah, okay. So color code is first. Now here's where we start building up from the bottom. So in order to build a channel, you need the color code, the frequency pair. You need the talk group, the receive group, right? Repeater slot. Now in most softwares, when you go to program your channel, you can't just type in the number of the talk group into the channel. Okay. You have to select it from a list. That means that list first has to be populated. And the place where you populate your talk group list is called the contact list, okay? So before you can build your channel, you actually have to populate your contact list, which is why we put it up here first, okay? All right. Now, the contact list isn't just for talk groups, for what we call group calls. We'll get to that here in a second. We talk about for private calls, which are for radio IDs. Hang tough, we're going to get to that. Talk groups, which are called group calls, okay, and the all call, okay? Now let's talk about this from least controversial to the most. All call is exactly what it sounds like, right? When you transmit an all call, any radio, if it's following the standard, it's on the same frequency pair setup, same time slot, and the same color code, will all open their speaker on the all call. Please be careful when you're using this. If you decide to use it, it can start annoying people very quickly. In RMHAM, we typically use this for simplex because it makes things a lot easier, but we're very, very careful about which frequencies we program channels for simplex use when we're using all call, right? We don't want to be transmitting on the same input frequencies on repeaters when we're doing this all call thing. It can cause problems. Okay, question. Any good software, when you select your entry for your contact list, it'll have a column to either choose private or group call. There should be a third selection for all call. Now, in the radios that support this, when you choose all call, it'll auto-populate the talk group number, which is like, what is it, 16-bit to, it's like 2 to the 16th bit. It's one long, long, long number. Right, it's the last possible radio or contact ID you can put into the radio. I don't know because I've never run into a radio that does that. Every radio that I program with a sample code plug has an all call entry. Okay, and if it doesn't, that manufacturer needs to be talked to because that's not cool. So again, be careful with all call. We have our channels put in for all call for simplex. We've double checked those to make sure they're not going to interfere with repeaters in our area. Your mileage may vary. Be very, very careful with all call. Be, you know, very judicious and double check if you're going to use that. Now, talk groups, which are also called group calls, are the things that we've been talking about this time, right? It's stuff that gets sent out on the repeater that goes out to other people as kind of a broadcast kind of thing, right? Now, the most controversial one as far as amateur radio is concerned is the private call. Now, private call has two overriding uses that have emerged in amateur radio. The first thing is that if your radio has a display, and it's really weird because people say, don't all DMR radios have a display? No. Remember, commercial use. And there's some people that just want to be able to push a button and transmit and receive. They don't need a display. But if you have a display on your radio, when somebody transmits and your radio receives, what it'll do is it'll show you the radio ID of the person that is transmitting. Unless the radio ID is in your contact list. Now, every contact list, when you put in a private ID, a private call, right, into your radio ID into your contact list, you have the ability to associate that with a name or a tag, right? Generally speaking, the way that we like to do amateur radio is call sign and name. So I have my call sign, in, you know, my radio ID in there, 3108120, and then the name or the tag will be K0NGA Mike. And if you have that in your radio, has to be in your radio, in your contact list, and I transmit, instead of that's why I'm a contact list junkie, for just that reason. Yes. Question from the internet.
Yes, we do have a question from the internet from Travis. He says, do you have familiarity, I can't speak this morning, with Motorola CPS? And obviously you do. What is the dispatch call and the PC call feature? You can put that on your list.
Okay, so let me clarify that. No, I do not have familiarity with the Motorola CodePlug software. There are some other fine folks in the room that do. I maintain most of the Chinese radio CodePlugs, and I will defer that question to people that have experience with the Motorola CodePlugs.
Well, I thought you did, because I thought you knew more than I did about this. But
no.
Dispatch call and PC call, I believe, are some advanced. I'm looking at Mark or others. I don't think we use those, so just ignore those. If you're using dispatch call and PC call, you paid thousands of dollars to Motorola to enable that feature. Seriously, they are advanced features, and you'll probably never see them, so don't check them.
That never happens.
And no. I could be lying to you, and I don't know it, but I don't think you're ever going to use those.
No. So there's that question answered. No, I eschew the Motorola's co-plugs and stuff like that for other reasons. It's a fun thing between me and Doug and whatnot. I tend to use a human readable names for our talk groups, like north, south, east, whatever, you know. Doug will always use the talk group numbers, like 720, 719 or whatnot. It's just a thing. But no, I have not been doing this nearly as long as Doug and John and them have been doing. They are the experts. I'm just a presenter. I defer to these guys. All right. Back to private calls. Now, here's the important controversial bit of this. This is it, and this is something that needs to be well understood. Within the specification of the DMR protocol, it is possible to do a private call through a repeater. Now, what a private call does is that you're actually doing a call to a radio ID. And that means only that one person's radio will open up the speaker when you're transmitting, okay? In commercial radio networks, this is fine because that's a feature that's enabled and whatnot. From the RMHAM perspective, in amateur radio networks, this is frowned upon because in amateur radio, it's supposed to be transmitting that everybody can hear. I consider it a form of coding, you know, of coded transmission or whatnot. It also ties up the entire talk group for a conversation between two individuals, okay? An entire time slot to just two individuals. This is not within my opinion, other people's opinion, the proper use of an amateur radio repeater, right? So even though the spec allows for it, remember that the spec is a commercial spec, right? Even though the spec allows for it, we strongly discourage it, and we definitely very strongly discourage it on the RMHAM network. Please don't do it.
And even though it says private call, It is not private on police P25. And we do have, for those online, two of our Firestone police officers in the room here with us. That would be known as an individual call or direct radio to radio. Okay. But the big thing is you're going to tie up the resource. No one's going to know that it's tied up except the two people talking or those of us with the diagnostic bridge.
Yep.
And you're going to think your radio's broken because you're getting a deny tone.
Yeah.
And then you're going to call us and we're going to say, well, we don't know what's going on. So we strongly discourage it unless it's absolutely necessary for some reason.
Absolutely. Okay. Now, as I mentioned before, radios will display the radio ID of a person who is transmitting if you have their radio ID in your contact list. It'll show the tag of the name instead. Now, this is where you start talking about some of the differentiation between the radios. Again, like I said, I'm a contact list junkie. I want to have the entire radio ID list in my radio at one point in time. And there are some radios and certain manufacturers who remain nameless who cannot or absolutely refuse to make their contact list that big. And it does affect my choice of radios, but that's me. So it's important to understand what you want in order to decide what radio you want to buy. Okay, and that's all I'll say about that for now. If you want more, contact me in private. And then typical contact names include a sign and name, as I said before. All right, cool. So now we've got our contact list, okay? So now we can start entering in our talk groups, okay? Access control is accomplished with talk groups, like I said before. So again, if you have two talk groups on a time slot and one person's talking in another talk group and you only have the other talk group in your receive group, you will not hear that conversation. Now, this isn't as fancy or as cool as people think up front, as I mentioned before. I think it causes more confusion and inoperability than it solves anything, okay? If a repeater uses a talk group, you must know which talk group you want to talk on in order to use a repeater, right? So not only do you want to know what it's on, what does the repeater support? A lot of times if you have a private repeater, it's not that big of a deal. You just need to know what talk groups they have open. If you're on a massive network like Brandmeister, it is crucial, right? Because you want to be able to, if you want to be talking on the California talk group, you don't want to accidentally be talking on the Florida talk group, different side of the country, right? Talk groups are assigned to a repeater slot and repeater. I think this is the third time in this presentation that I've mentioned this, but it's important. The repeater slot or the time slot matters as much as the talk group. Okay? That's still got some lag here. Come on. There we go. More than one talk group can be assigned to a single repeater slot, but only one talk group can be transmitting at any point in time. It doesn't matter what repeater you're on, even if you're on a hotspot, if one talk group is transmitting, another talk group cannot transmit at the same time. So if you're on your little mini hotspot and you've got five different talk groups signed up, and those talk groups start transmitting, which talk group is going to come out of your hotspot or even the repeater? The first one that started transmitting. And if the other talk groups transmit, they're not going to come out of your hotspot because the other one's active. Limits of the technology, just the way that works. Keep that in mind. Right. So I think I mentioned this before. So the general term for RMHAM repeaters, we like to keep it simple. One talk group per repeater slot. Most of the Colorado repeaters follow that. The New Mexico repeaters and the repeaters down in the Four Corners region have somewhat deviated from that to a certain degree. But generally speaking, we try to keep it simple. Time slot one or repeater slot one is generally always RMHAM with some notable exceptions. And then time slot two is one or more regional talk groups in New Mexico and Four Corners. In Colorado, it's one regional talk group. Okay, I think we've beat this whole talk group repeater slot thing into the ground, hopefully. If you're still confused about that, let us know. Now, this is what a contact list, a blank contact list looks like in the Anytone software. For those in the room, you'll see here the ID, the name, and the call type. Those are the three main things. So this is the thing that'll show up in your display if that gets transmitted to your radio. the type of call, and the actual number. Everything's numbers, talk group numbers, radio ID numbers, repeater ID numbers, whatnot. There is this thing called call alert. So you have these nice little tones that are already by default in your radio. And you can set that if that talk group transmits and hits your radio, it'll set that tone off. It's okay. It's a fun thing to do, but I never use them. All right. So that's what it looks like in the radio. Receive groups. Receive groups are fun. Now, in my mind, when you're talking about being efficient, or as I like to call it, lazy, right? The receive groups have kind of diminished in importance when you start talking about digital monitor. But if you want to know how to program the radio properly, this is the way it's done. So receive groups are how DMR radios use talk groups when receiving signals, okay? So the talk group are assigned to the receive groups, and the receive groups are assigned to the receive side of the frequency inside your software on the channel. We'll show that here in a little bit. But again, talk groups are assigned to the receive groups are assigned to the channel. Now, the reason I have to do this is because a time slot and a repeater can have more than one talk group on it, and you have to be able to tell the radio somehow to listen for multiple talk groups, right? In order to do that, they came up with the concept of a receive group. You assign the receive group to the channel, and then you put all the talk groups that you want to listen for on that channel into the receive group, okay? Anybody confused on that? This is actually the second most complicated concept in DMR programming. The first most complicated is the scan groups. That's a whole different thing. All right. More than one talk group can be assigned to receive group, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, this can cause confusion when scanning, because you can actually have multiple channels with the same multiple talk group, receive group on a channel. And whatever channel is scanning at the moment, when one of those talk groups hits, it's the channel that it'll stop at. So the scan may stop at a channel that transmits onto a talk group different from the talk group that triggered the scan stop. So if you try to transmit back, it's going to transmit on a different channel than the one that you were listening to. So be wary when you're scanning, if you're a scanner junkie, of this kind of thing. This is when we start talking. This is where it starts to get really complicated. This is why, another reason why it's generally not wise to have more than one talk group on a repeater slot in an amateur radio repeater. It's for the scanning bit. It can cause confusion. And if all of this seems, why in the world is it like this? Why can't it be simpler? Remember the DMR doctrine. This was created for commercial use, not for amateur radio use. And we're just shoehorning in, and we have to do the best with it that we can. Just about this, we're going to hammer this home one more time. Does anybody need a refresher on this? You have to know your repeater slot. You have to be on the same repeater slot as somebody else on the same repeater in order to communicate, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. So we're going to finish this a little bit up with this slide, and then we'll come back. This is, if you combine all this into a list, this is what that list would look like. Okay. The first example here is a standard RMHAM repeater. We've got two channels. The first channel is on the Rocky Mountain talk group on slot one. The second channel is central on the central talk group on time slot two. Two separate channels, same repeater. How do we know this is the same repeater? It's got the same color code and the same frequency pair. Dead giveaway that this is the same repeater, just two different channels in the same repeater. Okay. The bottom five channels are also the same repeater. How do we know this? Same frequency pair, same color code. It's the same repeater. Five channels. Okay. This is a very, very standard DMR Mark repeater. Now, DMR Mark has kind of popped out of favor. But over here, you can tell on time slot one, we have three talk groups, worldwide, worldwide English, and North America. And time slot two, we have two talk groups, local and mountain. But you can look at that at a glance and say, this is the same repeater. You've got two talk groups on one time slot, three talk groups on the other. So when you distill this out into a list, this is what that list looks like, if you want to conceptualize it in your head. This helps me a lot when I'm programming.
Just note that for that frequency example, 440.05, that channel is reused three times in the state. Once in Burlington, yep, which is a new repeater, mm-hmm, which is on color code 6.
It's on a different color code.
And the one in Grand Junction, which is on color code 8.
Which is another new one, right.
So, or it may be 7 and 8. You'll notice that the frequencies are the same, but the color codes are going to be different. And that's for the folks that do roaming. Roaming is figured out based on a color code. And if that color code isn't different, your radio is not going to know what site to actually connect to.
Yeah. Roaming is another pain in the ass, excuse my French, pain in the butt in amateur radio DMR, something that is an advanced topic that we're not going to go into right now. So is this time, how much time are we going to take for a break? So 15 minutes for a break. I have 9:38. So that means about what, 9:43? 9:55, be back and we'll continue on with the programming. All right, folks, we got about a minute before we get back started. If anybody can make their way back to their seats. Folks at home, go ahead and sit down with your coffee or whatever other beverage you may be enjoying. Okay, John says for the folks at home, if you click on the speaker view within Zoom, you can choose which camera you want to monitor. Choose me, because why not? Alrighty then, let's get started. So when we left off, we were looking at this spreadsheet representation of some sample channels. I know for me, this really helps me get my head around the various variables that need to be put in and to look at it and say, yes, I recognize these top two entries are the same repeater. These bottom five entries are the same repeater because they have the same frequency pair. They have the same color code, right? So it helps you get your head around it, okay? In our RMHAM sample page, if you pull down the now combined Connect Systems code plug zip, there is actually a spreadsheet in that zip file that is an export of all the channels from the code plug. So all the channels in the code plug will be presented to you in a spreadsheet format that'll have more information that you ever knew that you needed. So I encourage you that for learning and using this, to go and pull down that zip file and look at that spreadsheet. All right. Hey, we fixed the lag problem. Awesome, 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 awesome. Good downtime stuff. So now if we look at this channel, this is Squaw Rocky Mountain channel. We can now see in the channel representation in the Anytown software what the channel looks like when it's properly programmed. So we got the name. Let's say Squaw, or does it say Thornton? Can't tell, the resolution on this screen is bad. If I look at this screen, it says, yeah, Squaw Rocky Mountain. Now, looking at this, go down the list here. We've got our name for the people inside the room. We've got our transmit and receive frequencies. We've got our digital channel that is set at channel width 12.5 for a narrow band channel. Okay. We'll talk about some of the other things here in a minute. Over here though, we have our contact, which is actually your talk group, which is the Rocky Mountain talk group. The color code 7. The slot, which shows in here, in case you can't see it, says slot 1 without a space because Anytone and their Chinese program stuff. Your Rocky Mountain receive group is there as well. Okay, question from the interwebs.
Dante asks, who can I ask offline questions around hitting the RMHAM region-based repeaters via a hotspot?
You can email me. I will send you the link to the page. Essentially, all you're doing is programming a channel on your Brandmeister hotspot that, you know, matches your simplex frequency or whatever you have in your hotspot and transmitting on the proper talk groups. Again, if you'll email me, k0nga@arrl.net, I will send you the link to the page that has all of those mappings. It is up on the rmham.org website. All right. So that's what a channel looks like, okay? Let's talk about some other things. So if I look at this channel down here, let me see where it is on the actual things because sometimes it's hard to see. Inside the Anytone software, it's called TX permit or transmit permit. In other softwares, it's called the admit criteria. Remember what I said before is that sometimes the Chinese radio manufacturers, when they create their code plug software, which is what CPS stands for, code plug software, right? Actually, that was for customer programmable software, but I like to call it code plug software because it makes more sense. They'll change the name of things. They do this all the time. Just let it go. They're not going to change it back. But the admit criteria, okay? This is used to help prevent... color code. If the color code is transmitting, it'll give you a busy signal. If the color code isn't transmitting, it'll allow you to transmit with your radio. Okay? Now, for analog channels, we've run into some fun issues with the digital radios and the way that they translate admit criteria. And as a result, we've come around to having to recommend generally that you don't put access controls on your analog channels. And the reason is this is because a lot of the analog repeaters in amateur radio use a repeater tail. And a DMR radio typically will interpret this repeater tail as a repeater still transmitting. And if you have an admit criteria set for your analog channels, you'll never be able to transmit while the repeater tail is active. And generally speaking, it's very, very difficult to get into a conversation onto that repeater and transmit to that repeater when that repeater tail is active. We have to wait for the repeater tail to drop and get in real quick, or we have to wait for the conversation to end so the repeater tail drops before you can transmit. So we recommend on analog channels not having the admit criteria set. It's just the way things are, okay? Now this prevents doubling or transmitting at the same time without knowing on digital channels. Our default settings, as you see here, are what we set in our sample code plugs. Okay. Well, we talked about the radio ID. We have different sections in my presentation for things. This is why this is being repeated. Now, I told you before that the Anytone software does repeater IDs differently. Now, Anytone likes to kind of be on the bleeding edge of things. And as we like to tell people, why is it called the bleeding edge? Because sometimes they're so the features are out there aren't really refined enough that you're going to hurt yourself with it, right? The Anytone software allows you to pre-program in multiple repeater IDs into a radio ahead of time. Okay, so there's a lot. If you have multiple radio IDs, you can actually set those in. And if you go back to the channel, which we will do now, you will notice that every time you program a channel, you can set which radio ID that channel is going to transmit out on. Is this really a necessary feature? No, not really. But anytime you're in a competitive situation where you're competing with other manufacturers of a product in some kind of space, you need a way of differentiating yourselves. And this is one of those things that Anytone puts out there to differentiate themselves. I question the usability of this unless you're a really, really advanced user. But know that that's there. So it looks a little weird where in most radios, you just have one space somewhere in the general settings where you put in your radio ID. In the Anytone software, you have to go into the digital section, which is over here on the left. You can see not the public section, not the general section, the digital section, and they have a specific spot for radio ID list. Okay? And then you have your radio ID and your name. Right, so mine would be 310-8120, and then I have Mike Kaser on GA. But the only place that this little name shows up is in the channel when you select which radio ID you want to transmit out on. If you only have one radio ID, the channel's default to that one radio ID makes it easy. So one good thing about that. All right, now let's talk about zones. This is a commercial radio concept from my perspective, because I don't see this concept in amateur radio, analog radios, okay? I've got all these channels. Now what do I do with it? How do I actually get the radio to where it allow me to transmit out on it? Okay. Now, if you look at a handheld commercial radio or a DMR radio, which is a commercial radio, it has this little channel selection knob at the top, which you don't really typically see on an amateur radio, right? So what the zone does is it assigns channels to that knob, okay? Some radios, the knobs are absolute. You have 16 selections on the knob, and it stops, and then you have to go back, and you have 16 selections in the software. Makes it pretty simple, right? In some software, it's infinite. You'll look at the little dots or little demarcations on the knob, and there aren't any numbers on that. It's just because it goes around and around and around, and it never stops. And when you get to the last channel, when you click it again, it goes to the first channel in the list and just keeps going, right? Which one it is depends on which radio you have. I believe the Anytones are the infinite type. The Motorolas are definitely the absolute type, as I call it, right? Depends on the radio. Okay, so channels are assigned to zones. And a zone at the end of the day is just a list of channels. That's all it is. But this is how you tell the radio which set of channels you want to be able to transmit on that are currently assigned to your radio knob. Okay. Now, only one zone can be active at any point in time. You can have multiple zones programmed. So I can have a zone for when I'm in the north part of the state. I can have a zone for when I'm in the south part of the state. I have a zone when I'm in a different state. I have a zone when I'm in an altered state. Thank you. Thank you for laughing at that. Okay. But only one zone can be active at any point in time. Okay. Have as many zones as you want, but then you use the radio to select which zone is active. Okay. Now, on handhelds, this corresponds with a channel selection dial. Radios can have numerous zones. Have at it. Channels can be a member of more than one zone. So just because you assign channel XYZ to zone one doesn't mean it's not available for zone two. Absolutely. You can have XYZ in every zone you program if you want. Okay. Now, this is what a zone looks like in the Anytone software. Okay. It has at its most basic level, it has a zone name and a selection of channels, okay? Now, the Anytone software has two radio channels, right? So two different things, you can listen to two channels at once. So it does have this A channel and B channel default channel select there, okay? So be aware of that. But at its most basic, it's just a selection of channels in your zone, okay? Call your zones whatever you want. And then when you're in your radio, you go to the menu and say, I want this zone active, and it'll sign those, put those channels up on the dial, and off you go. Okay. Now, any questions on zones before we go into the frustration? Any questions for the interwebs? Okay. Now we get to talk about one of my favorite, least favorite topics of all, scan lists. What is a scan list? Guess what? It's a list of channels. Okay, at the end of the day, that's really what it is, a list of channels, right? If it's a list of channels, it's been a while since I've talked this long in a single day. So I'm starting to lose my voice a little. It's a list of channels that you want to scan at some point in time. Now, when you create that list in a DMR radio, that list is then assigned to a channel. Not to a zone, not to a radio, to a channel. This is where things start to get, if I want to be PC about it, it gets a little confusing or complicated. If I want to be not so nice about it, it gets kind of stupid. But again, remember the doctrine. The DMR is a radio standard meant for commercial use. Okay? Now, when that channel is selected, when you turn the knob and select a channel, and you hit whatever button you have assigned to the scan function, it'll scan the channels that are in the scan list that are assigned to the channel. Okay? Now, these lists can contain digital and analog channels. They don't have to be all digital or all analog. They can be a mixture of both, right? And some radios have some pretty advanced scan list settings. So we'll get that in a second. Now, here's what this means, and this is why this gets really complicated, right? So a couple of things to understand about the scan list and then sending it to the channel and when that channel's in the zone, that kind of a thing. The channels that are in the scan list have no direct relationship to the channels that are in the zone. There is no relationship between those two things, conceptually. Okay? Theoretically, you can also have a different scan list assigned to every channel in that zone. Not only that, if you have the same channel and that channel is in multiple talk groups, the scan list doesn't change for that channel. If you change the scan list on a channel, whatever channel, you know, whatever zone that's in, that channel in the zone will have that new scan list. It makes managing your scan lists very complicated. Okay, that's just something that you have to get your head around and have to get used to, okay? The way that we do it in the sample, because we try to keep things simple in the sample, and that's an alliteration that was not intentional. So whatever channels are in the zone, we create a matching scan list with the same channels, and we assign that scan list to the channels in that zone, just to keep it simple. But just because we do it that way doesn't mean that's the way you have to do it. Do it whatever way makes sense to you. Now, there's some gentlemen in the room that were talking about the scan list earlier and how that kind of worked, and can you do this kind of thing? Does this make more sense? To cause what we think is the least amount of confusion when using scan lists. They are not by any means the way that we recommend you doing it, just because there are so many things you can do with scan lists that it would be very confusing if we try to get fancy with it. So in our samples, we keep it simple. In your own code plugs, go into these things and change them all you want. Okay? To give you an example here, this is a scan list inside the Anytone software, right? Yes. Okay, the question, so I'll try to read the questions as I go. And I did that with this one. I forgot to add it, the question at the beginning. So here you have a list of available channels, and here's the channels that have been assigned to the scan list, okay? Even in radios where you're limited to the number of channels you can put in a zone, generally speaking, you can put more channels in the scan list than you can in the zone on those radios, okay? Now there's some advanced things at the bottom, okay? There is something called a priority channel. A priority channel one and a priority channel two. What that means is that as it's going through the list and scanning the channels in the list, it'll give more priority, which means it'll check that channel more often than the other channels in the scan list. That's what that priority scan means. Okay. So if you set one of the channels in there as a priority channel, it'll check a few channels, go back to the priority, go check a few channels, go back to the priority. It'll check that channel more often. It's essentially what that means. Okay. Now, the revert channel down here can get a little confusing. And again, this can get confusing based on how it's termed and how it works in certain radios. But generally, that means that when you stop the scan, when you stop the scan, it'll go back to the channel that it's assigned. This one is when you go to transmit after it stopped at a scan, what channel is it going to transmit on if the scan's still active? Okay. We have some loopback times, dropout times, and dwell times. Again, these things, of all the things that can differentiate between channels, these terminologies and features can change the most from radio to radio to radio, from manufacturer to manufacturer. The only way you're going to get your head around what they actually mean and what the differences are is to actually read the manual. I know that's terrible for technical people like us to actually admit that they read the manual. I do it all the time. Okay. So that's a scan list. Question about scan lists. So that bit about that a scan list is assigned to an individual channel has tripped up a lot of people again, and it's the most confusing thing outside of receive groups because of that, right? It's just the way the protocol and the way that the programming and the DMR and commercial radios work. It's assigned the scan list to the channel, not to the zone, not to the radio. Now, if you want to be able, no matter what, what a channel you're on, you want to be able to scan the same scan list, what do? Create one scan list, assign it to every channel. You're done. But you have to assign it to every channel. Now, the good thing is that if you only have one scan list, when you create a new channel, it defaults to that scan list. So it makes it easier to program, but that's conceptually what you have to do. Okay. We're going to start into networks next, but this is the end of the content that I have for programming a radio. We're not going to talk about roaming because roaming differs in the way that conceptually it works between the manufacturers. Three manufacturers I'm aware of that have the capability of roaming are Motorola, Hytera. Those two things I believe work kind of similarly, and Anytone, which does it completely differently. And it's annoying. The thing that you want to understand about Roam is that what Roam does, it allows you to add channels to a list, and that it will key into and allow you to transmit on the repeater with a channel in that list where the repeater has the strongest signal. Okay, it's great if you're mobile and you need to be able to get the repeater nowhere at yours. It allows you an automatic selection. Now the key here is that when you think about, well, I've got multiple talk groups on channels that I can put into the same list. How do I know which talk group it's going to land on? The answer to that is you don't. What if I put two channels in a Roam list that are two channels from the same repeater but are on different talk groups? Which talk group is it going to stop on? You don't know. So it's a commercial technology that has, in my opinion, limited functionality within amateur radio, unless you pick one talk group to monitor and transmit on. So the great example here is that if you're choosing preferred roam, bring a roaming car, and we're doing all of our communication on the North Talk Group, you can make a Roam list with North Talk Group and let it go, because you'll know whenever it ends up on, it's going to end up on a North Talk Group channel, which is fine. That usefulness is great. Outside of that, it can get really dicey really quick. So that's all what I'll say about roaming. Yes. It's really hard to explain because they don't do the roaming. They don't do. So the question is, what is so different about the way the Anytone does roaming versus the Hytera and the Motorolas? And it's really hard to explain because the way that they do their setup of their roam lists in the Anytone software is not by channel, but by frequency and repeater slot, which makes absolutely no sense. My only guess is that they do that kind of mapping to that between the channel list, which is how they make it happen, but it makes no sense when you're putting it together inside the software. And it just gets really confusing really quick. I've used it twice and it seems to be okay. Not great, because it's the interval between checking for new repeaters is you have to set it. So it's not gonna constantly check, and it's not gonna check frequently. They'll check however you want to do it, like every 5 minutes, every 10 minutes. And so if you're in a dead spot and you're at the beginning of that interval, it'll be 5 minutes before it pops in and tries to get another repeater. Yeah, Kenwood, I don't know. I have no experience with the Kenwood radios. I can't comment on it. It may not, I don't know. Any other radio programming questions? I'll pause for a minute to let questions come in on the chat before we get in the networks. Okay. We're having a comment on the floor that's going to the microphone. Stand by.
Okay, we'll try the microphone. You didn't give me the red one. I knew that it had some level challenges. So, one of the things that, I've done some, the programming for Kenwood and some of the other radios. So I've used, your code plugs a lot of the time with the Anytone for an example. But I was just going to point out, when John puts something on the website or we get a new repeater, I try to get it in. And just something to keep in mind, especially with some of the stuff in New Mexico, is when you're putting the frequencies and some stuff in, is pay attention to the receive and transmit frequencies, because New Mexico is backwards from what we're doing here in Colorado.
Not backwards, they're different.
Yeah, they're different. So I just kind of wanted to point it out as the challenge from, having to work and roll some of my own code plugs.
Yep. Don't let that catch you. All right, the mic is being passed to Willem.
So this is the impossible question. How do you know that you programmed the radio correctly without actually going to the repeater and testing it? The problem being, I'm an amateur radio operator. I know how to punch the buttons on the front of my radio. Mm-hmm. If I screw up an analog channel and I'm in the field, I can fix it.
Yep.
I don't have a computer with me in the field when my DMR channel is broken. So how do I prevent, or how can I avoid having programmed something incorrectly and not discover it till it's too late?
All right, so this is not an impossible question by any stretch, but there is a little bit of religion here as well, so I have to be careful how I answer this. All right, so generally speaking, you could choose to take your computer with you, which kind of defeats the purpose of the question. Can you know that you're right without transmitting? No, can't. So how do I fix it? Well, it depends on your radio. And without naming any names, there are certain radios, because they do dual duty as an amateur radio and a certified commercial radio, that don't allow front panel programming. The advantage of having an amateur radio-only radio is that they don't have to follow that. Programming, which means you can fix things in your channel settings without having to use a computer. Okay. Now, since Willem brought up this particular scenario, I feel honor bound to bring up another thing, which is the DMR radios that are sold to the amateur radio market are not necessarily certified to be used on commercial repeaters, or be used for commercial use. You have to be very careful about that to make sure they're certified. This has become a problem for certain companies. You decided they were going to save some money and buy amateur radio DMR repeaters and use them on the commercial networks, and it caused issues. So be wary of that if you're a commercial radio user. If you want your radio to do dual duty for both commercial and amateur radio, that you must make sure that your radio is certified for commercial use. So that was a very good lead-in question for that. Thank you, Will. But if you're programming a radio and you don't have your software with you, you don't have a front panel programming, and you don't know if the channel is going to work, the only way to check it to make sure it works is to transmit and see if you get something back. The only way really to effectively do it, unfortunately. If you're on a trip, please take your laptop with you to be able to fix that, or to check with your feature set of your amateur radio focused DMR radio to make sure that it supports front panel programming. Very good question. Other programming questions before we move on? Nothing from the interwebs. Let's move on. Let's talk about networks. Woohoo! Transmit permit. Okay, so to go back over that real quick. Same color code. Again, this comes back to one of those things, like it depends on what you, they use different terminology in different radios. The ones that I see are color code or color code free. If it says same color code or different color code, same color code. Well, it depends on how they terminology. You might have to look at the manual for this, because the same color code means that transmit if the same color code is detected or not detected. Check your manual. Because nobody, it's completely inconsistent. And I've never, again, I've never seen color code same or different. I've never seen that I don't think I've seen that in a code plug. Good Lord. Okay, so repeater networks. And yes, the little subtitle is my attempt at humor. One of these things is not like the other. Okay, so what is a repeater network? Very simple. It's a repeater network comprised of two or more repeaters connected together in such a way that when one repeater receives a transmission, it is broadcast by the other connected repeaters. Pretty straightforward thing, right? We connect two repeaters together. This repeater gets a signal. It transmits it, and the other repeater transmits it. Okay? Allows people in one area, if your repeater network's wide enough, to be able to be heard in another area. Okay? It is important that you know your network. Okay, RMHAM owns repeaters in DMR repeaters that are on two different networks. Most of our repeaters are on our own RMHAM network. We do have a repeater, our Lee Hill repeater, that is connected to the Brandmeister network. Okay, and before our little experimental connector, you could not transmit on a RMHAM talk group or the RMHAM repeaters on a Brandmeister repeater. There had to be a bridge set up somewhere, and that's been done, again, experimentally. But generally speaking, if you want to talk to Brandmeister, you need to talk to a Brandmeister repeater or hotspot. If you want to talk on the RMHAM network, you need to talk to an RMHAM repeater. Again, outside the hotspot connectivity and Brandmeister, that kind of a thing, okay? Now, generally speaking, the three most well-known networks in Colorado at one point in time were our network, the DMR Mark network, and Brandmeister. DMR Mark is starting to fall out of favor, in favor of Brandmeister, generally, but there are still some repeaters out there. These networks work a little differently based on how they use the features of the repeaters. And the only way to get really full on how they work is to check the repeater network's websites. And it's important that you understand the difference between a static and a dynamic or user-activated talk group. This is where things start to get fun, okay? Here is a general map of the RMHAM repeater network. I believe the link for this is bit.ly/RMHAM-TRBO-map. We've moved most of our terminology back over to DMR instead of turbo, but in that particular case, I made this map a long time ago. In the northern part of the map up here, we have Cheyenne. In the southern part of the map, we have our Sandia repeater down in Albuquerque. We have some new repeaters over here in Grand Junction. I believe that one is Rangeley, and that one is Burlington. Okay. Now, I made this map, and the colors generally map to the region that the repeater is on. The yellow ones are north, the blue ones are central, the red ones are south. With some notable exceptions of our VHF repeaters and our Brandmeister repeaters, those kind of a thing. The New Mexico repeaters are still in South. I haven't broken them out yet, but again, the ones over here in the Four Corners region and in New Mexico will have multiple talk groups on the second time slot or repeater slot. Generally speaking, that'll be the New Mexico talk group, which is 505. Okay, not from New Mexico, you don't know the significance of that. A local talk group, which is specific to the individual repeater, right? And then the Four Corners area has their own Four Corners talk group. I believe that's the extent of it. But that's the map. That's where all the repeaters are. Okay, so our network is generally speaking a bit simpler than other networks in terms of the structure. We had five original talk groups, was north, south, north, was announced north, and then central, which used to be Denver, now central, south, Rocky Mountain wide, used to be called Colorado wide, But since we then expanded into New Mexico and Wyoming, it didn't seem appropriate to call it Rocky Mountain Wide. And the local talk group that was on the Lookout Mountain Repeater. We've expanded a little bit since then. So we have talk groups such as other local talk groups. So the New Mexico Repeaters have their own local talk groups. The Devil's Head Repeater has its own local talk group. Eastern, which is mostly VHF today, that may change, again, as things do. Four Corners and New Mexico. Okay? Now, generally speaking, if you want to talk to somebody in our network, what you should do conceptually, it's not always possible to do this, is to use the smallest talk group area that you need in order to contact them. So if you're both in the Denver area, and you can both talk on the Lookout, and you can both get to the Lookout Mountain Repeater, Lookout Local is what you should be using. Because that way you're not tying up the other repeaters for your conversation. It's not always possible, right? So if one of you guys is in Burlington and the other guy's out here in Grand Junction, you can use the Central Talk Group because you have access to repeaters that are on that particular network, right? If you are in any of these repeaters, you can use the Four Corners Talk Group. But you know, if somebody's up in Cheyenne and you're down in New Mexico, you're down in Albuquerque, and you want to talk to them, the only talk group you can use that'll let you accomplish that is Rocky Mountain, right? And that's fine. That's cool, right? But if you can make it smaller, you know, make an effort to do that. All right. So that is our network. Now, the reason why, one of the reasons why this is so simple, and we were talking about this over the break, is that the RMHAM network was designed to easily affect emergency communications, right? It's not exclusively used for emergency communications. We want you to do rag chew and use the network, but the design was there in order to make things simple when the emergencies happen. We don't want to be guessing where our signals are going to be going out on. We want to know if I transmit on north, which repeaters are they going to go out on? If I transmit on south, which repeaters are they going to go out on? Okay, that needs to be a certainty when you're talking emergency communications, okay? In direct contrast to that, we have the Brandmeister network, okay? General concepts behind Brandmeister, worldwide network, many, many, many talk groups, right? So we have a very limited number of talk groups on our network. Brandmeister, the sky's the limit, okay? As a concept, all talk groups on Brandmeister are dynamic, okay? Which means if you have appropriately configured Brandmeister repeater, you as an end user can activate a talk group on that repeater. Any talk group that's available on Brandmeister, you can activate. So they're all okay. If you are in Florida, you can't activate a talk group on a repeater in California, right? You have to have signal access to the repeater that you want to activate the talk group on, okay? And in order to use this, desired talk group has to be programmed into the radio with some advanced exceptions, which go into hotspot concepts, and we're not going to go that deep today, okay? Now, there are two ways to access the Brandmeister network. There's traditional repeaters, like our Lee Hill repeater. Okay, and a hotspot. Now, a hotspot basically is a little piece of hardware. It can be a off-the-shelf piece of hardware, or it can be a board that you add to a Raspberry Pi, something like that. But generally speaking, it'll connect out to the Brandmeister network to one of their master servers via the internet, and then you set up either a simplex or duplex frequency on the hotspot for your radio to talk to. You talk to the radio, it sends the signal to Brandmeister, and off it goes. It's basically a concept of a mini repeater, okay? Now, so if you think about this, if you're in Florida and you want to talk to your friend in California, again, you need to be on the same talk group. This means you're going to have to activate the talk group in Florida, and your friend's going to have to activate the talk group in California, and then the two of you can talk. That is the most difficult part about Brandmeister. The upside is that you don't have to ask your local repeater owner to activate or to make the talk group active for you. You can do it yourself. And it is this flexibility that has made the Brandmeister Network the new hotness. Okay. That's why this is so popular, because you don't have to wait for your repeater owner to do it. You can do it. You can activate it yourself. Okay. There is the Brandmeister website will allow you to monitor the traffic on the entire network. It has a last heard that'll show you who transmitted to what talk group from what repeater. And you can see which talk groups are hot. And there are days where that last heard just flaps by like it's, you know, like it's rain falling, you know, or sometimes when it's a lot less quiet. So you can use that to gauge which talk groups are popular, and you can program the radio, transmit in and get in the conversation there. Or if you don't like the conversation that's going on, don't, right? The other thing, important thing to understand is that the labels for the talk groups conceptually are arbitrary, right? So like there is a Colorado talk group on Brandmeister 3108, okay? What does that mean at the end of the day? Nothing. It's just another talk group. Some guy in Florida can transmit, can connect into 3108 talk group and talk on the 3018 talk group and be talking to a guy from Florida who's on the 3018 talk group. It's labeled Colorado. Maybe they were both going in to talk to a guy that they knew from Colorado and met each other and started chatting. It's an arbitrary label, okay? You may hear some people get upset if you come into a talk group that has a the TACT 301 or some other talk group that has a specific purpose to it and start talking about other things. They may get upset, but there's nothing in the rules or whatnot that says that you have to stay on topic or that you can't do it. It's courtesy, right, at that point, right? It's end user courtesy, but it's the wild, wild west as far as what labels and arbitrary things mean for the talk groups. At the end of the day. So just gauge how you will, right? You can, if you are a repeater owner or if you have your own hotspot, you can choose to make a talk group static on your device. So if you always want to have a talk group active so that when anybody talks in that talk group, it comes out your hotspot, you can do that. Or if you're a repeater owner, you can do that, okay? But all talk groups are dynamic to start. The only thing that makes them static is that someone decides to make it static on their device. Make sense? Questions about that? One more thing. So the way that Brandmeister works in the back end is that there are three, there might be four. The wiki tends to fluctuate here, but there are a number of master servers in the world. There are three in the United States that are definitely three in the United States, or maybe a fourth one, but they're all meshed connected together. So all the master repeaters are connected together. And whatever device or repeater or whatnot is connecting into the Brandmeister master server, it does all the translation for you. So the hotspots tend to use the homebrew protocol. Motorola repeaters use IP Site Connect and all these kind of things. And the purpose of the master servers is to do the translation. So if I'm transmitting here, I'm transmitting to a Moto Turbo repeater, it goes out through IP Site Connect to master server one, right? It realizes, hey, that's talk group 42, right? There's a guy on a hotspot on this other master server that has a talk group 42 active. So it's gonna send that signal to that master server. That master server is then gonna translate the signal into homebrew protocol, and then it's gonna go out to that hotspot and transmit out his hotspot as talk group 42. So all the master servers do all the translation and all the routing of the signals to all the other master servers that have those talk groups active somewhere on a repeater or a hotspot that are connected to it. It's in concept extremely simple when it comes to the backend connectivity, because all you have to worry about is connecting your hotspot or your repeater to the nearest master server. And the master servers do all the rest. Okay. Questions about Brandmeister? Brandmeister in a 10-minute nutshell. Any questions from the interwebs? Okay. I'm not familiar enough with it to be able to talk about it. Yeah, so let's I think hold off on that until we get more specifics. Is this the access control thing? Okay. So one thing to understand about Brandmeister is that the way that you, there's many, many different ways if you're a repeater owner to connect into Brandmeister. One of those ways is to use what we call a C-bridge, which is what we use to connect our own repeaters in to with each other within our RMHAM network. Works with IP PsyConnect. You can put a C-bridge between your repeater and the Brandmeister server, the Brandmeister master server. And what that allows you to do as a repeater owner is to control which talk groups that are allowed to go out through your repeater to manage it. That's a more PC way to say it. There has been some thought process around this within RMHAM. As far as I know, there's no decisions that have been made. If you would like to comment on this particular possibility or concept or whatnot, just let us know. You can email me or email one of the other technical committee members within RMHAM. You have a comment here? Your mic's on. Doug suggested that a small donation of $100 or more might make it more apt for us to check your comment. I always have to carry a complaint. Yeah. John was holding up a complaint form. It was some kind of monetary bill.
I'll take the complaint form. Yeah, I was just going to make a comment, you know, from playing with hotspots, fairly new to it. And I know this is with DMR, but the kind of the interesting with the hotspot and Brandmeister, if you kind of go out and look around, there are some talk groups that from your DMR radio that you can link into somebody that's running a D-Star or system confusion, one of the other digital protocols. So, you know, it's kind of interesting to see that it's not, the hotspot is just not DMR, but you can use your DMR to do cross-platform to other digital technologies.
You stole my thunder.
You should have got it sooner.
It's in the presentation.
Here. I'm not paying attention to that.
So there's two things there within the comment they just mentioned. One is that the hotspots support more protocols than just DMR and Brandmeister. The other is that the one of the fun things that clubs are doing now is connecting between these disparate networks in the back end. So when you transmit on their DMR repeater on a talk group, it'll go out through an analog repeater, it'll go out through a D-Star repeater and such, and they're all connected together and happy and that kind of thing. These particular efforts have met with mixed success based on which club you're dealing with. All right, so let's talk about hotspots. It's one of my favorite topics. I will not commit to naming just how many of these I own, because not because I'm ashamed of it, just because I've lost track and I don't know, and I'm ashamed of that. All right, so what is a hotspot? Generally speaking, a hotspot is a small portable device which connects over the internet to one of a list of networked repeater systems allowing communication via certain types of radios, most commonly digital radios. Okay, a lot easier to do digital with these kind of things. Now, what I want to stress here when we start talking about the RMHAM network and why should I use the RMHAM network kind of thing, is that the key limitation to these particular devices in an emergency is that whole connects via the internet. Okay? You cannot, in an emergency, depend on the internet being up. And it's a concept that we at RMHAM take very seriously. All of our as many repeaters as we can in our network are connected via direct site links. We do not like to depend on the internet to connect our repeaters together. Okay? It's one of the reasons, one of the things that makes our network different when it comes to MCOM is that if the internet goes down, our repeater network continues to function. Okay? Hotspots don't have that luxury. They depend on the internet. It's something to be aware of when you're using these. Okay. Now, why do I want one? Okay. First question, do you really want one? in the past, they've been a little clunky. Some people have a hard time understanding the concepts. It may be more frustration than it's worth. You've got repeaters in your area, use them, okay? If some of the ways that you, some of the reasons why you may want these is that you are having coverage issues, okay? There's no repeater in your area, bless you. You drive around in dead spots a lot. That never happened in Colorado, right? Repeaters in your area are too busy. I don't think we have that problem here, thank goodness. Or repeater owners block the talk groups that you want to talk on for Brandmeister type things. These are all valid reasons to want a hotspot. And why not? For the fun of it. Heck, whatever. Something to play with. Perfectly valid reason. Correct. And because we don't, John says we don't support it on our normal system, and what things we do support are still experimental. Okay. Now, typical radio protocols supported by these things aren't just DMR, but DMR is supported because this is a DMR class. We have to mention that. They also support D-Star. Not only do they support DMR and D-Star, but you can transmit to the hotspot on a DMR radio and transmit out to a D-Star network and vice versa, which is a whole lot of fun. System Fusion C4FM, the latest off-the-shelf hotspot Shark RF, which makes the open spot 3, now allows you to switch between all three of these. There used to be, when it was DMR and System Fusion, it was D-Star that was the odd man out. I'm sorry, I misspoke. Because D-Star uses a proprietary codec. They've managed somehow in the open spot 3 to get past that, and now you can interoperate between these networks and radios, which is kind of wild. Other protocols, NXDN, P25, and POCSAG for some reason. POCSAG, if you don't know, deals with pagers, which seems so 80s now. I don't know. Gosh, but hey, you know, in this world of in continued automation, being able to trigger an event by sending a text message, why not? Okay. Networks, DMR networks. This includes things like Brandmeister, DMR Mark. You can do DMR Mark with these things, right? We do not have direct connectivity into our RMHAM network. We have bridging via Brandmeister, as I mentioned before. So technically, that's the Brandmeister supported, the Brandmeister network supported, not the RMHAM network. D-Star reflectors, which includes DCS and XLX, REFs and XRFs, so reflectors and repeaters. System Fusion, FCS, and YSF reflectors, and on and on and on. Most of this support is done via software. So if something comes up, we can make a change to the software, update to the firmware, and support more things in the future. That's the great thing about them, right? So this is fantastic. So you're not just buying a hotspot and only having to be limited to DMR networks and DMR radios. They can spread across multiple networks, multiple protocols, both for the radio and for the networks that you're on, which is very, very cool. So you're going to get a lot out of this investment when you invest in it. Now,
question.
Got a question.
Travis Speakman says, just to clarify, I can have an out-of-state friend come up on Central 310801 if he programs his hotspot for it?
Correct. If he's on coming through Brandmeister, correct.
If it is that generally discouraged on the network?
No. Please do it. Just understand that support today is experimental, which means it's not always stable because we're still learning, right? So if it's down, let us know it's down, but please be patient with us while we make that particular process more stable. But yes, you can do it, and we encourage you to do so. All right, hotspot selection. Which hotspot? There are two different general types. There is the turnkey, which by far the most popular is the Shark RF open spot. I will not admit to how many of these I own. Now, this is actually out of date. The current spot is the open spot 3. The open spot 2 and both the open spot 3 are very low power. They sip power. It's fantastic, which means you can run them for a long time off of those one of those USB battery things. Awesome. Wi-Fi is built into the OpenSpot 2 and the OpenSpot 3. Okay. So you don't have to use the OpenSpot 1 had an Ethernet connector, and you had to use an adapter to get out to Wi-Fi. The OpenSpot 2 and the OpenSpot 3 have Wi-Fi built in with no Ethernet adapter. Okay. So it makes it much more flexible. And there's various USB dongles that you can get to plug into your computer to go out for it. I don't like those because you have to have the computer on in order to do it. And you have to reboot your computer, you lose your signal, da 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 da. Okay? Require a computer. Okay. Now, the OpenSpot 3, they've added a more powerful processor, that kind of thing. But the biggest thing is that they built in a battery into the OpenSpot 3. So you charge the battery. You can still power it off an external battery, but you're not required to use an external battery. It also has a physical power button, which is nice. It also has a button to reset the Wi-Fi. If you're somewhere else and, oh, I forgot to set the Wi-Fi up in the device, you can hit a button that resets the Wi-Fi and allows you to get in through your laptop or phone to change the Wi-Fi network that you want to connect to, right? Now, the other major type is the kits, the build-your-own, the shields, the boards, and what kind of thing, okay? These typically require a processing board to use, such as a Raspberry Pi. There are many versions, including Chinese knockoffs. Buyer beware, right? You can get caught into this. Please research and make an informed choice before purchasing your hardware, okay? There is assembly required by definition. And the most common software for these devices is the PiStar software, okay? Now, I'm not going to get into a religious discussion between proprietary and open source software. That discussion has been beaten to death all over. The key message here is that there is a path, regardless of which way that you tend to lean. There is choice, and that is a good thing. All right. Which one is better? Which one should I choose? This is, as I will say, my personal opinion and does not reflect necessarily the attitude of the entire RMHAM club. This is my opinion, okay? If you don't want to fiddle around with it, if you want something that is plug and play as possible and you have the money, get an OpenSpot. If you want to get hands-on, like building kits, have some extra time, don't mind doing a little research, and to want to control all of your options, go with a kit. The one that I have is the ZoomSpot Raspberry Pi combination. It seems to work very, very well. It's also very well supported in the community. And generally speaking, as PiStar software is released, it's released first for this combination. So I stuck with that. That's how I made my decision. Okay? Questions on hotspots? Willem. Should you, I didn't hear the first part of the question. Into the satellite band?
Oh. Yeah, the question is, where in the satellite band should I tune my hotspot?
I feel ashamed because I should have added this to the presentation. That's a very important point. So.
And why did we ask that question?
That's a very good comment. And here's why you answer that question. When you set up your hotspot, you have to set it up. And again, let's talk about setting up as a simplex frequency because that's the most common for hotspots. You have to tell the hotspot what frequency it should listen to from your radio. There was a point in time with the ZoomSpot Shield where from the factory, it would default to a frequency on that setting that was in the satellite control band. Satellite transmit band, whatever. And it caused interference. This was a big problem. They had to change the firmware so that the actual default frequency fell within the amateur radio band. It's very embarrassing, but it brings up a very, very valid point. You need to have a way of determining what frequency you should set your hotspot to listen to your radio and transmit back to your radio. There is an answer to this, and that is your state's frequency coordination organization. Okay, there is one in Colorado. I forget the actual acronym in the name of it. The Colorado.
Yeah. It's ccarc.net.
And that is the Colorado Council of Amateur Radio Clubs.
There is a frequency use plan. You should look for a simplex frequency on there. There are a number of them. And also note that the CCARC will be meeting in approximately 2 weeks, and additional frequencies have already been approved, but we have done a poor job of communicating that. And that will be further discussed of how to get those out. In that expansion area are a number of, is that on CCARC, John? Okay, well, we're gonna be publishing more information, but there are some in the 446s, there are some in the 445s, the corresponding 440 and 441s, and there also are some new ones that have been approved in the 438, 439, and the corresponding negative 5 megahertz. So look for those. And what Willem was referring to is there is an individual in the Westminster area that has decided to put up a Echolink node, even more power than a hotspot, which hotspots are typically well under 1 watt.
Yeah.
And he chose 432.1 megahertz. That is the national single sideband weak signal calling frequency, and specifically excluded in part 97 from automatic, auxiliary, and repeater operation. So there are some frequencies at 432 and then 437 that you are excluded from. So don't put your hotspot on those.
Yep.
The CCAR frequencies are listed and verified to be the right place to put you.
Yep. There is a section on that website called frequency coordination. There is a downloadable PDF for each band. Most of the hotspots I've seen and I don't think I've seen on anything on VHF, have been on UHF. So you pull down the VHF PDF. On the right side of that page, there is a list of digital voice simplex frequencies. It is my recommendation that you pick a frequency from that list, because it would seem to fit most closely to the purpose of, you know, your hotspot, because you're doing digital voice and your hotspot is transmitting out on simplex. Makes them nice and safe. The best thing to do. Be wary of the frequency that you're setting on your hotspot, for the love of everybody else. All right, at this point in the presentation, we're going to open it up for general questions, other topics, and that kind of a thing. I'll leave up on the board right now some links. Obviously, the RMHAM website, there is the link to the map that I tried diligently to maintain about our RMHAM repeater locations. A lot of those locations are not 100% 0.0 foot accurate for various reasons, but they give you, you know, the general good idea. This presentation will be up on PDF form on the website, so you don't have to take pictures. You can download the PDF. So if you have questions, if you want, now be careful. Network the audio feed, which is hose, because I call it the hose line because it's like drinking from a fire hose, and the wiki. And my email address at arl.net. So at this point, if you have questions in the room, raise your hand. If you have questions on the Zoom, please either put it in the chat or unmute yourself cautiously and ask your question. Any chance of a sample code plug for Hytera PD-782? So the question is there any chance of a code for a Hytera PD-782? I used to maintain that, but that radio is so, that shows so little utilization that no. I stopped maintaining that code plug. They don't sell it anymore. Also, the amateur radio focused version of that, we just hit an interesting snag. And that is with the latest repeaters that we put into the, I think it's the AR, whatever it is, the A version of the Hytera amateur radio focused radio, which I also don't sell anymore, just reached with the latest entries of our repeaters, the 128 channel limit. It's one of the only amateur radio focused radio that has a 128 channel limit. It's, in my opinion, again, my personal opinion, it's kind of pathetic. Yeah. You might want to look at possibly, again, this is up to you, but selling that PD radio to a commercial user and buying a different one. But no, there would not be. And that's, again, one of those radios, the Hightower radios are not supported by the N0 GSG utility. It's a pain.
Travis, hello, come on. Travis also says, I'm working on a Kenwood NX3000 series, specifically NX3300 code plug. Who can I give it to so I can get it up on the RMHAM site?
So we have requirements for putting code plugs up on the RMHAM site. This is something that we need to put out on the floor. First thing, it must follow the sample code plug format that the other code plugs have, right? It has to have the same layout of channels, zones, scan lists, those kind of things to match what we have. That way they're consistent among them. It cannot be your own selection of channels, however much you want that. It just has to be follow our sample code plug format. The second thing is that you must commit to updating those code plugs when new changes need to be put out. Generally speaking, the changes that are done are when we add repeaters. If you do not agree to add, these channels to your code plug, your code plug will be taken down from the site if it's not maintained. Now, used to be when I did my samples, I would also update the contact list. Anybody that's tried to do that knows just how crazy that has become now. The cool thing is that with certain radios like the Anytones and the Terra radios, there is a list that's published for you that you can import on a daily basis. For the other radios, if you're supported by the N0 GSG utility, then one of the main things that the N0 GSG utility did up front was allow you to import the contacts from radio ID directly into your code plug. So there are ways generally with your radios, especially the Chinese radios, to do contactless management without me having to do it. And in fact, it can be more updated if you maintain it yourself. But if you want to put up a code plug, contact me, contact one of the other members, but it needs to follow the format and you need to commit to updating them when necessary.
And this is Doug K2AD speaking, since I don't think I'm on video. We do have an effort. Oh, there we are. Hello. Well, now I got to put my mask on. As the technical director in RMHAM, I started at some of the other board members' request a effort to do exactly what Mike said. We'd like the code plugs to be as similar as possible, and we're trying to drive a standard of certain zones for VHF and UHF. We have not achieved the VHF yet. We're working on that. We are working on UHF, kind of a pseudo standard, and also a small team of Mark Skelton and 7CTM, Derek, Yarian, K1DCY here, and myself, small amounts of time, really they're the brains, are also working on Kenwood NX3000 code plugs, NX5000 code plugs, and I've been working on the NX1000 code plugs. So if you have something for that, do you want them to send them to me or to Mark? But send them to the K2AD address and we'll socialize them. You know, if you want to put additional zones in, that's fine. But we're asking, try to get as much of the zones as possible, acknowledging number of zones, number of channels, contact lists may be different. The way that the radio operates may be a little bit different. So we can't be so black and white of, well, if it's got to be exactly the way Motorola is or exactly the way,
doesn't always work.
But we try to get it as close as possible.
Right.
We're working on it. We'd love to collaborate. So send them in to either K2AD's address or W0VG's out there, and we'll put them together.
One of the perfect examples of that is for certain radios on the Central Talk Group, right? So the Central Talk Group is now expanded to the point where it's so big that for some radios it won't fit in one zone. So we had to split it out into Central East and Central West in order to make them fit. Mexico's not there yet. One of the cool things about, because when we, South got big until we decided that Mexico really should be its own zone. So once we split New Mexico out in the same zone, it solved that issue. But like I said, there's certain radios that allow you to put all the channels from central into one big zone. Other radios don't. So it's not, you're not always going to be able to technically be able to go one-to-one for all of our code plugs, but we have ways to get around that, because even within the radios that I maintain, you have to make amends for certain radios. One of the other things that I need to do, and this is on me, is that the Anytone radios and are dual band. So technically I should be putting the VHF channels into the dual band, into the Anytone dual band radio code plugs, and I haven't done that yet. So I need to do that and get onto that as well. So as things change, as technology changes, as new radios come out with that kind of thing, we just had to find a way to make our code plugs match as best as possible.
Yeah. Further comment, our VHF offerings are somewhat experimental. They're limited. We've primarily been a UHF group, only because VHF channels are kind of hard to come by. The 2 meter band is very full. We have been able to obtain some because DMR utilizes half the bandwidth of an analog repeater, and we're able to get some VHF channels. So we're doing that. In some cases, we're putting the Rocky Mountain wide talk group. I won't give the number for respective mics.
It's 700.
It's 700. We're also running an Eastern talk group, and John wants to get in, but we're also doing some experiments on those for other features. So I'll turn this over to W0VG.
Okay, there's a question in here from Mark N9EDK. He says, a general question, why DMR versus P25 versus D-Star versus whatever?
So my opinion on this, and other people can back me up or argue as they will, is because DMR is an open standard, okay? And DMR being an open standard, it means that anybody can make a repeater, anybody can make a radio, right? So it makes it broad. It's been broadly adopted. You can get a, like I said, I mentioned before, you can get a working radio new that supports DMR for less than $100. I think the MD380 is the one I'm talking about specifically, and it seems to keep creeping down in price. It used to be 100, it was 90. I've actually seen them for around $80 now because they've become so ubiquitous. So you can get the on the end user side, the barrier to adoption is very low. On the back end repeater side, especially when we're talking about Motorola Moto Turbo repeaters, because of IP Site Connect, they're very popular because the interconnect protocol is built into the repeater. It's very, very, very easy, if you know what you're doing, and most, but we have enough experience and we know what we're doing, to interconnect those together either via directly through C-Bridge or through the Brandmeister Master repeaters. So there's enough knowledge there, and again, with the fact that they're narrowband and the fact that they have two time slots that allow you to get more effective utilization out of the same bandwidth combined together to make DMR as popular as it's been today. Is it the only game in town? No. Does it mean that you shouldn't use other protocols? No. But this is really why it's been so popular. We get a lot. We've had some, and I want to talk about this because it kind of models my brain. In certain areas of the country where I presented, you get some admittedly more experienced hams that'll come up to you and say that DMR is not real amateur radio. What is real amateur radio, right? The whole thing about amateur radio is that it's experimental. We do the stuff to this things that nobody else would do, and we come up with solutions no one else would have thought about. That's the spirit of amateur radio. It's not a protocol. It's not a technology. It's not a frequency, right? It's a concept. So I think us and RMHAM take a very, very strong issue with that sentimentality. And it doesn't matter what protocol you're using, but RMHAM is popular for a reason. It's popular for its flexibility and for what it can do with bandwidth and the clarity of the signal and that kind of a thing.
7AIH. The sample code plugs on the website are samples. They're templates to get you started. They're not the permanent end-all solution to your radio. So the sample code plugs will get you on air, but you will make that code plug your own.
My presentation, right? Let me go back while I'm doing this. So do we have another question while I'm doing this, John? Oh, yeah. But that was meant to be a sample. remind people to do what? To change the radio ID? We did that at the very beginning. That was very, very early on. Oh, yeah. So I'll get to that thing when I get to here. Yeah. It's so funny. Yeah. So here's my comment here. DMR programming. To experience true DMR freedom, you must learn to program your radio yourself. Me, constantly. Learn to program your own radio. Please. I'm using my dad voice. Right? Now, obviously, and this is something that I've been asked to remind folks, when you get the sample code plug, we did something sneaky. We put in the radio ID in the sample code plug. I believe it's like 12345 or 52421. And then we put in, when our samples, it's 12345 or 52321. And then we put in the contact list that radio ID with the name RMHAM sample. So if you forget to change your radio ID, we're going to know. So don't be that guy. When you pull down the sample, you open up your software, the first thing you should do is go in and change the radio ID. And then save it so you don't forget. Because if you forget, we'll know. And we will call you out on it. We will do it politely and friendly and whatnot. But you will, yeah, change your radio ID. Other questions in the room? Other questions from the interwebs? John, any more questions from the interwebs? It is 11:11. This was actually one of the shorter sessions. It was great. All right. Are we ready to call it? Okay. That's all I had. Willem has one last comment. He's going for the microphone. There's a microphone there. Well, then you have to get the microphone because someone's going to hear you. All right, Willem's coming up to the lectern with a microphone to say a few words.
Well, first of all, I just want to thank Firestone again and Doug Sharp for getting us this room. We actually have a very nice room here. We can probably fit about 20 people. So for future RMHAMs, if you're interested in attending in person and you feel comfortable coming out, we will do all of the proper social distancing, and everybody's wearing a mask unless they're actually sitting at their desk.
So, and they have an individual, 3-foot by 6-foot table desk? It's spaced.
So it's a very safe environment. If you feel comfortable coming out, we will probably have the majority of our RMHAM universities for this semester here. So, please use that, avail yourself of this wonderful facility that through the good auspices of Doug, the city of Firestone has made available for us. So thank you very much. Thank you also to John and Rob for running the AV system here. And our next RMHAM University is the second Tuesday of next month, and it will be on IP networking and routing. So John W0VG and myself will present that. So we'll have the NetLab here, and sort of if you always wanted to know exactly how IP networking works, hopefully that'll be a good one.
Hey, Willem, you said the second Tuesday. I believe that's your test in the class you're teaching at CU. On the second Saturday, we'll be here to talk about IP.
I'll be here on Tuesday. You come on Saturday.
Just have one of the officers let you in. The police station is always open.
So sorry about that. Yes, Saturday. We are looking for to do one or two of these RMHAM universities just somewhere down south, because you know we are fairly far north on the in the state. So for the people from Colorado Springs, if you want to attend in person, that's quite a drive. But we just haven't found a facility as nice as this that we can do that safely. So stay tuned. We'll let you know if the site changes. back and sharing his knowledge.
DMR is something I'm very passionate about. I enjoy doing it. The last thing I'd like to say is that I've learned over the years that there really is no such thing as a truly stupid question. We learn as much as we do by people asking questions we never thought about as we do as just learning on our own. So do not hesitate to email us and ask us questions over the email. We encourage that. We enjoy that. And we will get back to you as soon as humanly possible. But yeah, don't be afraid to reach out.
I guess I'm back on. This is a question for Willem. So what do we got to do if we want to support RMHAM? And if you want to tell us a little about the supporting and some different things.
You're asking the wrong person. Is Jeff Ryan still on here?
Let me take that. So, because I say this every time on our DMR net. So the first thing you can do is you can go to smile.amazon.com and choose Rocky Mountain Ham Radio as your charity of choice. You can also go to King Supers and on your little card, go into the website, sign in there, and attach your card as your charity to Rocky Mountain Ham Radio as well. You can also donate directly through the website, either on a one-time or a monthly donation using a credit card processor. We'll take checks, we take cash, we take blood donations. No, we don't. But there are various different ways that you can support us. And the cool thing about the King Supers and the smile.amazon.com is that those supports do not incur any additional charge to you. All right. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming. We appreciate it. Have a good rest of your day and email us if you have any questions. Thank you very much for attending.